concerning meditation, concerning how to go about meditating Panja word day and night, in hopes that we may be able to somehow bring forward some insight as to how to go about this and how to receive this. We will be focusing our attention on the book of Genesis, chapter 18, which is titled here, and we are referencing from the Old School Field Reference Study Bible, Abraham, the friend of God. And so we're going to be using this chapter to, you know, do that which we attempt to do: illuminate I and thyselves, including all others willing to receive, at least we hope, in ways of becoming good meditators. But before we go forward with that, we must explain fear. We'll be focusing on the plains of Mamre. This is a place of growth and a place of learning. Before we go into details as how that came to be, or how it came to be that we accept the plains of Mamre to be such, we must know and establish the need to fear itself, you know, no fear. That is not the spirit that we've been endowed with. We must be of courage and of good faith, you know. Fear. Growth is the opposite of fear. Fear, hate, terror, you name it, you know. Any negative thought, any negative frequency, vibration, aspect, or way of which to observe things is an obstruction to growth. Let us try to, I guess, kind of break this down somewhat. We see all throughout history that human life has failed to move on ahead and grow into a progressive state in which we further increase betterment and conditions of living for all men, women, and children within this human community, for the simple reason that we have been in a state of fear, whether it be fear in manifesting itself in the form of hate, of any kind of negativity, low vibrating frequency. We as a human community have been kept in, we have kept ourselves in this low vibrational field in which it is not possible to grow and learn and become better. You know, science is so-called pretends it to be you know, concluding certain probable conclusions in order that we may prevent mistakes or errors from happening in future times. But it seems like as a human community we fail to learn from our mistakes, and this in fact is a state of it is insanity. We commit the same mistakes over and over and over as if we were bound or chained to our past mistakes, and that is not the case. Get Achen Jesus Christos frees us from the chains of our forefathers, ancestors, from our previous mistakes, and frees us in order that we may correct them and thus, you know, continue in this eternal growth. Now, you know, if we were to explain this somehow, in a, at least attempt to explain it in a biological psychologist sense of study field, whatever they call it, in, you know, in that in that area of study, we would have to use to explain this the state of fight or flight. It is recognized in biological psychology that the way that that human behavior works is that when it feels the sense of fear, when the human body feels threatened, or if it senses to be in a position of terror, of hate, our automatic or automatic, we're not too familiar with all the, you know, all the terminologies for these things, but the part of the lower brain that is that works automatically, it kind of takes the lead, it takes charge, and it locks the body in a state of fight or flight. And what that means is that no longer is blood being pumped into the higher mind of creativity and learning and progress, but rather it shuts down all thinking, and you know, locks the body in a state in which all it does is prepare for attack, prepares a defensive, and only acts on violent objectives, or immediate flee. Our muscles become contracted, so that the tension within them allow for a rapid strike, or possibly a rapid takeoff. You know, taking off, running, fleeing. Our eyes expand, the pupils of the human eye become larger so that they may be aware of any potential dangers. Blood begins pumping at a more rapid pace so that we may prevent a certain situation in which we are losing blood. It freezes the human body in a state of panic, and it shuts off any energy, any fluids, any blood reaching the higher mind. And what that does, it leaves a people in a frozen psychological state, which we find ourselves in today. No one can go beyond that, which is their main concerns, which is the stress. And the stress allows for the human within this community to maintain his focus on survival and not ever go beyond the lower forms of man or life. You know, and this must be done away with. Once must become freed of fear in order to even begin to attempt meditation. You know, bear with us, we're trying to bring this together somehow. Now, the average man, woman, or child within this human community is too occupied with the notion or the make-believe that they must pay this bail or bill, they must pay that bail, that bill, they must conform to him, conform to that, that they must assure themselves of another day, assure themselves of food. They are worried and preoccupied with Babylonian system, matters. If someone's gonna attack them, if someone's gonna rob them, if they're gonna get assaulted, if they're going to be stopped by a policeman, servant, if they're going to pay their bills on time, if they're gonna make enough money, if they're gonna wear the right shoes, if they're gonna wear the right shirt. Constantly in a state of panic, of fight or flight, and thus we see what we see today. You know, war we're accustomed to, animal brutality, no big deal. Rape, murder, it's all good. But to look within oneself, that's where the average human within this human community draws the line. You know, it's like we could see a whole people become, you know, through genocide, become extinct. But to look at oneself, deep within oneself, is soul, and confront the demons that are being manifested on the outside, which are in all reality within, that's where we draw the line, right? We've said this before. When it comes to life, America backs down. When it comes to death, murder, rape, all the atrocities that this world, that we have made manifest upon this world, America's all for it, you know? But God forbid that we speak about life. So, in, you know, basically what we're trying to say is that if you fear what one is going to say, if you fear this, fear that, forget it. You will never become bigger or better than you have ever been. It's, you will, you know, eternally become damned within that low consciousness realm and suffer the sufferings of fear for all eternity, for that is where your spirit and your soul and your energy is, and that is where you will stay, because there is no opportunity of betterment, of growth within fear. So one's must overcome fear. And, you know, as we shall see and attempt to kind of somehow apply this to the apply what we just said to the scriptures, now we have here the friend of God, not just any God. Chapter 17, the book of Genesis, it's where the Almighty, the Elohim, the Spirit Creator, he makes himself known. He appears to Abraham at that time as El Shaddai, as the Almighty. El Shaddai is interesting. It comes in a form of the breasted one, the one that can nourish, the one that can strengthen. You know, kind of like the breasted female. One is a child and he sucks on the breast of one's parent or guardian, and thus becomes renourished or nourished and re-strengthened. And that is in a sense how the Ibrahist, the Hebrew, describes El Shaddai, nourishment. This signifies the strong one, you know. The qualifying word Shaddai is formed from the Hebrew word shad, the breast, invariably used in scripture for a woman's breast. Now, so therefore means primarily the breasted. God is Shaddai because he is the nourisher, the strength giver. And so in a secondary sense, the satisfier who pours himself into believing lives. So just to give somewhat of a detail as to what we are to expect. So now the friend of the Almighty, the All-Powerful, it gives us here, Old School Field Reference Study Bible gives us some references to John chapter 3 verse 29 and John chapter 15 13 verse 13 of 15. Now John is interesting because he always, like a breast, inclines or leans or bends or bows, you know, but the action of being a satellite is a follower of, you know. So John is always after the heart of Jesus Christus. He's always leaning towards his bosom. His bosom is where the heart is. It's El Shaddai, the strengthening breast. He's always feeding off of Jesus Christus. And so we could see the connection with the friend of God, you know, being nourished by our God. And so it says here, and the Lord appeared. So there's an appearance here. We must know that every revelation that has ever been made manifest to any individual, and it doesn't have to come in the form of an angelic figure appearing or anything, just most people call these revelations coincidences, right? But if you step outside of fear and attempt to become better and bigger than we have ever been, ampler in our crook, bigger in spirit, so on so forth, then we will be able to see these revelations. And so the appearance is, in a sense, the appearance of the Almighty God, in this case to Abraham, is in a sense how we are confronted with certain revelations, and those revelations are intended so that we may become nourished and lean towards a certain power, the only power, and blessed be him that trusted in the Lord our God, and thus in time accept truth for what it is, become full in our faith, and as El Shaddai also means, Almighty God El Shaddai not only enriches but makes fruitful. So okay, let us go on forward. So, and the Lord appeared to him, to Abraham, in the plains of Mamre. Plains is a terrible King James translation. It's a grove of oaks. It's an oak tree. It's not a plain, but it could be a plain in the sense that we're pretty sure, and this is speculative because the scripture doesn't actually give us the information that we ourselves personally in it. Alonso will reveal, but it is most probable that they are in a valley or in a plain, in a depression, because of the similarities of all revelations within scripture. They tend to keep certain patterns, and so if El Shaddai has just, if God has manifested himself to Abraham as El Shaddai, then it is most likely that, and being that El Shaddai is relative to breast, female breast, then it is very likely that the plains of Mamre are actually in that it actually is a plain or a valley or a depression, a place in which is at a lower elevation, we could say, than two other points to its sides. And we'll go into some more information or revelation as to why that is so. So the plains, but there are oaks, because that word plains is oak in the Ibraist, in the Hebrew. And that's interesting, and because that is actually our name. In the Be'amarinya, in Amharic, it would be Alon, and then in the Ibraist, it would be Elon. And so, meaning oak, meaning power, and eventually goes on to reach its root, which would be chayil, ale, you know, power, and strong, robust, firm. But I guess now that we made mention, because sometimes we've made mention, or we have presented ourselves as Alon Kone Teferi, which would be Elon. And we've kind of explained or given a brief definitive as to what that means, and Kone would be the Amharic, similar to Hone, but the state of being, the existing. So being strong, being robust. We didn't pick the name, you know, so we're not trying to, you know, exalt and ourselves, that it's just what it is. But let us go on forward. So where there is an oak tree, there is a well. Where there is an oak tree, there is wood. Where there is wood, there is salvation. Where there is wood, there is a cross. Where there is wood, there is interstructure or instruction. There is burden. It's a place right below your skull. Okay, ones have to imagine the whole breast again. El Shaddai and the plains, so meaning a depression, and two mounts on the side. We'll leave that at that, and we'll pick up on some details on the forward. Now, in the Be'amarinya, Amharic, Mamre would be, well, it's actually pronounced this kind of the same way, but we have here that it sounds a lot like Memhir, which would be a master, a teacher, you know. And so we have a place of learning, and we have Mare in the Be'amarinya, in the Amharic, which is defined as compassion. So we have a place of learning, of instruction, under the shadow of things to come, under the rest of Yeshua, you know, whom hung on a tree so that our sins may be purged or cleansed. You know, there's so much within this. Okay, imagine the blistering heat of Ethiopia and a group of individuals in the heat of the day.
Excuse
me, you kind of lost that train of thought, but okay, imagine you're in Ethiopia and it's the heat of the day. What are you gonna do? There's an oak tree. You're gonna rest. You're gonna receive peace in knowing that Jesus Christos hung on that tree, on the oak. He is the strength, the foundation, that the crossroads to our salvation. And so, you know, just imagine what are people gonna do, a group of a school of individuals going to do in the heat of the day. They are going to be protected and go under the oak where there's an oak tree. There is a well where there is a well, there is water. Water is teaching. So this is a place of instruction, a place of learning, a place in which ones sit and become taught. Now it says here, and the Lord appeared, so there's a vision to him in the plains of Mamre. Even in the memory, in the membrane, we could even say there's so much within this. So where there's a tree, there's a brain. Where there is a grove of oak trees, there is a channel, a narrow passage. And so keep all this in mind. Well, let us go on forth and describe or define the words in the Ibraist. We gave some interpretations as how to define these words in the Bamarinya and Amharic. Now, some of the Ibraist, the Hebrew definitions to these words would be Mamre would be kind of like a place of rebellion, but also it would be a place of whipping, kind of like a whipping a horse with a leash or lash, in order that the horse gains speed. So this is a place of training, a place where ones become faster, where ones become quickened with the spirit. It's also a place where the wings are flapped, the wings of a specific bird. We kind of forgot what bird it was, right? But it is recognized as a place where there is flapping of wings. And so the fact that we have the whip, you know, whipping from one side to the other and the flapping of wings, that could give us some context into the geography in which there is a depression. You have wings as your back has wings. You have your shoulder blades and your back wings. And then you have kind of like a depression where the stem of the trunk of the oak tree, which would be your neck, and then, you know, eventually leading up to your brain. And then as well, that's the reverse side. The front side, we would have the breast, which is exactly the same thing, but in a different kind of direction, in a sense. And so the depression would be kind of like leaning in towards your chest and being where, you know, all the goods are drawn out. In this case, you know, and leaning in towards the heart of Ch18. And so the flapping of the wings, it's a place of growth. It's a place of taking off. It's a place of learning, a place of becoming bigger, better, and you know, reaching a higher state, a higher way of life, a higher sense of looking at things. Even a bird, he flaps his wings and he takes off and he's in the air. He has a top view of everything. He no longer sees everything in the eyes of one trotting the land, but rather he's looking at the whole scenario. He's from a higher height, you know, he's reached a higher elevation, and thus his eyesight becomes widened, and so on and so forth. And so that's just to give ones kind of like some insight as to how to define these words in the Ibraist, in the Hebrew. Now, and the Lord appeared to him in the plain of Mamre. So, oh wait, and he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day. So in the tent door, we don't necessarily accept this to be his tabernacle, but rather the tent door, the entrance to his higher mind, you know, we could even say Abraham was tripping. You know, he's kind of like, you know, if ones want to, you know, see him stoned or something. But he's just like, you know, just, you know, in the higher heights, you know. you know, this world would kind of say, well, we're not going to go into that, but he's daydreaming. We'll put it to you this way. If for any reason there's not a school around him, you know, seeking after the shadow, the shade, the protection, and the rest of the oak tree, then he's definitely daydreaming. And he's just standing there, you know, at the heat of the day. He ain't at work. He ain't doing nothing that conforms to Babylon's system. He ain't worried about, you know, paying rent. He ain't worried about eating or whatever. He's just there, you know, at the heat of the day. And so he lifts up his eyes. So there's a lifting. He flapped his wings and looked, and lo, behold, the Nehore'e. Three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them. The three men that stood by him, he was quickened, and so he made a move. Why? Because he was not in a state of fear or panic. He was not thinking about his bills. He was not thinking about Babylon system preoccupations and stuff like that. He's just, you know, being free and, you know, just living his life. And so he took off. He became quickened with the spirit, and he made a move. He judged righteously. He ran towards these three men, and when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself towards the ground. He inclined himself, he bowed himself, he humbled himself. He's walking humbly alongside his creator, and he sees three individuals. Could these three individuals be messengers? Most definitely. But it was up to him to judge righteously and go and obtain those messages. It's the same thing. Our spinal cord, it's a freeway of messaging. You know, all of our senses have kind of like roots or canals leading towards the spinal cord, and it is definitely a way of describing the gates in which we are to set judges and officers, that we may know what to receive, what messages and what angels and what angles, points of views to receive, and what to discard and what not to let in within I and thyself. And then we have a door leading up to the higher heights, which would be the neck onward, but more specifically where the reptilian brain ends, and then you reach the bird brain or the higher brain, and you know, the arc and stuff like that. But let's not get ahead of ourselves, as we have kind of already done. So and he said, my lord, if now I have found favor. So he found favor. So these revelations indicate the favor that he has been favored amongst others by the creator spirit, and he's being presented with opportunities to become faithful, judge righteously, and trust in him that is revealing these things to him, thus eventually becoming one, walking alongside and standing before his creator. And so if I've found favor in thy sight, pass not away. You know, he is not going to let this opportunity go away. You know, don't let grace pass you by. Due diligence in seeking, and you shall find. And blessed be them that okay, we'll get into that, but forgive me, we'll just hold on to that thought, you know, because it's the second time for those that look for him the second time, then he shall come, you know, perfect, bringing salvation to all. And a lot of people don't realize that, right? A lot of people don't expect anything, or are not even waiting for anything, because the name of Kitachin Jesus Christos, even Germawik Edamawi Alis Lasi, have been taken in vain, as if we're not to think that they are real and just make believe, pretend. But that's not the case. So let us go on forth. That's another topic. Now, I pray thee from thy servant, don't, you know, he declares himself, Abraham, as a servant, let a little water, I pray you, be fetched, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree, under the knowledge that Jesus Christos, even though we as Christians may commit sins and do commit mistakes, we know that we have a chance to be forgiven by the Almighty. Now, continuing forward, and I will fetch a morsel. So this is becoming, here are three strangers, right? And Abraham is treating them awfully well. So he himself is acting mercifully. He's comforting. He's inviting these individuals with an invitation so full of compassion. Who can resist, says His Imperial Majesty concerning the Bible. Who can resist an invitation so full of compassion? So Abraham, you know, he fixes up quite a bargain and treats these strangers, presumably. After that, we'll fetch a morsel of bread and comfort ye your hearts. Who's to tell whether these men should be comforting him? But nonetheless, Abraham is becoming that friendly figure, loving his neighbor, loving his fellow men and women, children within the human community, without distinction as to race, sex, religion, gender, like all that stuff. So he's acting in the image of which he was made. So now let us go forth and comfort ye your hearts. After that, ye shall pass on, for therefore are ye come to your servant. And they said, so do as thou hast said, so fulfill, you know, do that which you said you shall do. Sounds good. And Abraham hasted into the tent and to Sarah, and, you know, said, make ready quickly 3 measures of fine meal, knead it, and make cakes upon the hearth. And Abraham ran to the herd and fetched a calf, tender and good, and gave it to a young man. And he hasted to dress it. And he took butter and milk and the calf which he had dressed, and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree, under the shadow of things to come. Old Testament, New Testament concealed, New Testament, Old Testament revealed. Now, under the tree, and they did eat. So they eat the breaking of bread. So now we have here a common union, a common unity, you know, talking about scripture this, scripture that, Yeshua this, Yehoshua that, you know, Yahashua, Jesus, and so on and so forth, you know, under the oak, under the burden of the life which they have chosen to take under that path, you know. And so Sarah, thy wife, where's Sarah, thy wife, they say. And he said, behold, in the tent. And he said, I will certainly return to thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah, thy wife, shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent, which was behind them. So now we have, here's a promise, you know, I will certainly return to thee. So there's a promise, there's a appearance, you know, we could say Yeshua, crucified, and then, but I will come to thee. And it is for them that look for him the second time that he shall come, you know, pure. Let us just, you know, because that's in our head for some reason. So let us just do, you know, speak that word of truth so that we have peace of mind. It's going to be, it's the book of Hebrews. It'll probably be chapter 9, maybe. Yeah, okay, chapter 9, book of Hebrews. And let's begin from verse 27. Kind of, we could give it some brief context. And as it is appointed to men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Verse 28, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and to them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin to salvation. There, we can, for some reason that was in our mind, and now we can, you know, rest assured, go forward. Now, and certainly I will come. Okay, we read that. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of woman, so on and so forth. You know, they trusted in him that nourished and re-strengthened them. They were kind of about to die, and they became satisfied, they were rejuvenated, we could say, even to the point where Abraham was able to perform his deed as a male and satisfy Sarah, and thus, you know, bear a child, even though the womb of Sarah was not as the manner of women no more. So, you know, we don't want to spend all day here, so forgive me for, we didn't intend to actually read the whole chapter, but we'll get to this one point. So verse 14, it makes mention, is anything too hard for the Lord? You know, kind of, so he just revealed himself in chapter 17 as El Shaddai the Almighty, so surely there's nothing too big or too difficult for El Shaddai. And so let us leap forward to verse 16. And the men rose up from thence and looked towards Sodom, and Abraham went with them to bring them on the way, you know, courteous, we would say. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? So here we go, meditation. Even El Shaddai is meditating. He's thinking within himself, you know, which brings us to our main, we thought it would be our main focus. Even the Almighty is meditating. He's showing us the way to meditate. He's thinking within himself. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? He's obviously not saying this aloud, because then Abraham would kind of, you know, find out that something's going on. So he's thinking, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? Which brings us to meditation. There's a lot of you know, a lot of ideas out there that somehow sitting quietly, humming or listening to some, you know, particular kinds of music, and just reaching a point of nothingness, that ones will get something done. We don't know, but that sounds like a waste of time. They're becoming one with motionless. They're becoming, you know, those meditations where you know, you cross your legs and stuff like that. How is that gonna do anything? Granted, it is difficult to reach a state of completeness, of union, but coming to union with what? They're trying to reach a state in which there is complete nothingness. We're not saying it's completely bad or anything, but it's not going to get no work done. So the meditation is to become learnt and grow. So meditation is a reflection within oneself, where one meditates and thinks about things over and over, and talks to himself and answers questions and asks other questions, and repeats certain things he goes through. You know, ones can go through their day. What did I do? How could I do it better? What happened? See, it's a place of learning, a crossroad to the higher mind, where you could actually not have to carry that same burden, but learn from it and never have to go through it again. A place of learning, of instruction, inner structure. A place, you know, of movement, of action, not of inert or frozen fear. Because that sounds like the meditation that a lot of these Buddhist and Hindus practice. We're not saying that the strength of prayer is not at all a strength, but we are in space-time. You know, space must move. There must be action. You know, we must act upon those things which are required of us to act in. So the script is a roll, and we must get the ball rolling, you know, unroll the scroll and play the script, you know, live it, become it, you know, as a sacrifice, and choose ye this day life or death, and whom it is that you will be likened to. Within this this theater, if we call planet Earth a theater, it has become a comical, because things are so bad. It's even funny. And as for my role, as for my part, says His Majesty, I glory in the Bible. So here's your script, read it, act it, you know, don't become one with nothingness. And if that's the life you choose. We're not saying that that is all that bad. But let us go on forth. So El Shaddai is meditating. Shall I tell Abraham that thing that I do? And so this is the testing, actually. we're kind of gonna lose focus a little bit, but this is kind of a testing of Abraham. Watch, this is what happens. And seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him, for I know him. I know that Abraham, he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him. And the Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which is come to me. We don't know what they call it, semicolons or whatever. We don't know really what they call it. But then it says, and if not, I will know. So that "and if not, I will know" is pertaining to, shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do? And it's a test. Abraham's being tested. Is Abraham going to intercede declare or demand the justice due, the people whom justice is due, and speak and make manifest righteous judgment? Abraham does. You know, he passes the test. Under the oak is a place, in the plains of Mamre is a place of testing, a place of rebellion, but also a place of obedience, a place where you win some, you lose some, but you continue forward and not become shut down in a state of fear. So it's a crossroads, right? The cross between, we could say the lower mind and the higher being, and the intellect and the creativity and the intellect, the Greek, the Jew, the Greek, in complete unison, you know, not seeking after sign and not seeking after wisdom, but partaking, coming into perfect union, and receiving of both as revelation, that we may trust in him whom it is only trustworthy, power creator, you know, in and through Yehoshua HaMashiach Ben HaElohim Jesus Christos Yeget Achen Amlak Achen Enamet Chanit Achen. Even you know, Abak Edus Germaik Edamai Halis Lassi. So you make the Aber Moambesazem Negera Yehuda Negus Negest Ze Ethiopia. So let us go on forth. So we're not gonna continue with that. So basically, you know, Abraham begins to speak the justice due the people, the righteous people, in Sodom and Gomorrah, and so on and so forth. But basically, just to conclude, let us bring forth this way in which we can meditate upon the word day and night. So we have an automatic or onomatic or autistic, you know, whatever they call it, the reptilian brain, the part of the brain that is designed that to keep all the automative functions running well, properly, without us having to take the time to remind ourselves to breathe, to pump blood, to, you know, to do this, to do that, that we may become better and bigger and more spiritual and stuff like that. So we have that part of a brain, and we have a higher brain. We can use that lower part of a brain. It's not bad. It's actually very useful if one could apply it properly. Read scripture, familiarize oneself with scripture, and we know that one excuse will be, but we have to go to work, or we have to take care of our children, or we have to do this or that. Leave that up to the automative or automatic part of your brain. Honestly, we in before times have been made fun of. We were in our some employment, they would make fun of us because they would say that I thought myself to be so smart that I would only send the body to work and the mind would stay home and rest. And you know, well, we would just like not care, right? But that's exactly what we would do, except the mind was not at home resting. It was at you know, resting within the tent. You know, we put our body in, and anyone's can do it. You know, practice makes perfect. You know, basically just trip, just, you know, go on a trip. You know, is what they say. You know, let your wings soar and just take off. You know, ones could just, if you're washing a car, just keep washing it, but then have your mind be thinking of those higher things. That's exactly what it is. This ain't nothing new, nothing extraordinary. It's just not being caught up with your problems, and whatever it's gonna be, it's gonna be anyways. And when personally, when you've had a life just, you know, full of experiences that aren't that, you know, positive, then it becomes easy to be like, man, who cares what even happens? It's not like it's gonna be anything that's never been done to I. So it makes it easy in that sense. And if you're hated by the world, it makes it even more easier. And if you've been popular in school and have a lot of friends and, you know, hang out in all the hot spots and do the worldly things, then it's gonna be really difficult for you. And if you're rich and have a lot of money, it's gonna be extremely difficult for you. So we don't know what to say. We pray for you. You know, there's much grace in Jesus Christ, so it's not impossible. But nonetheless, you know, if whatever it is that we're doing throughout our days, we could always leave our higher mind in under the oak tree. You know, we could always be in the plains of Mamre, becoming better and bigger and learning and, you know, gaining that progress for Ethiopia that is much needed. And even another way is applying scripture to life. Just find ways that ones could kind of like include scripture in daily activities. There's always time. It's just that we don't learn the ways to make time for it. Personally, all we ever talk about is scripture, and if not exactly directly scripture, we'll make the conversation go towards relativity to scripture, basically. So I mean, scripture indicates, you know, and you'll be talking about this everywhere, to your children, to, you know, strangers, to here, to that. You'll be thinking about it, you'll be reading it, you'll be desiring it, it'll be on your walls, it'll be on your forehead, it's your life, it's our life, you know. So with that, you know, we actually give thanks if ones took the time to listen to the whole reasoning. This is Wendell Malanto, co-producing, excuse me, for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society. Be sure and support Melik Media House, .wordpress, Rastafari Renaissance, .wordpress. Make sure to sign up to Rastafari Foundation. Support the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society. Do your own thing. Let us know what ones are doing. We'll do whatever we can. We try. Whatever little we find out, we try to, you know, do anything to support it. And so until next reasoning, Shalom, Rastafari.